All right. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to a new Current Conversations. Our guest tonight is Dr. Millie Solomon, the president of the Hastings Center in Garrison. We're going to be discussing herd immunity, what that really looks like, how we can get there, the challenges ahead. This is our first event with using Crowdcast, so things are going to be looking a little bit different than some of you are used to from Zoom. If you want to ask a question, there is a button below the video that says ask a question. I see there's already two questions in there, so you can also go in and vote for the ones that you really want to see us get through. You can also use the chat on the right just to share your thoughts or, you know, whether you agree with something or not. And yeah, I think that's enough housekeeping for me. I'll just leave it over to our editor, Chip Rowe, and Dr. Solomon to take it from there.
Teresa, we're getting messages that there's no sound, that the audience can't hear us in the chat.
Oh, I think that might have been before we went live.
Oh, okay.
I hope. Can everybody hear us okay? Can you let us know in the chat? All right. Thank you, Ryan. Thank you, everybody. Okay. Excellent. Thank you for bearing with us. It's our first Crowdcast event, so we're still figuring it out. All righty.
Thank you, Teresa. Thank you, Millie, for taking the time to for this. I wanted to say first, I know that you are having your own discussion on Tuesday that we can certainly plug, the Hastings Center. Hastingscenter.org, and I think the difference between that conversation and this one is that will have three people who know what they're talking about. This one only has one, which is you, of course. But I have many questions, and if people aren't familiar with the Hastings Center, it's, you know, a top-notch bioethics, I don't know if you like the word think tank, that kind of gets banned around, but, you know, it's a lot of very smart people, a lot of scholars, thinking about ethical issues and moral issues, and how, as we kind of go through all these things you see about in the news, you know, what are the issues we should be thinking about? It's a fascinating website, sort of a black hole, because you get on there and then it's one of those places you end up for an hour clicking from one thing to another. But I thought first is something, I have a hard time with herd immunity. I don't quite understand it, because I see in some things I read, I think Dr. Fauci has used 90%, you see 95%. In, you know, the discussion for Tuesday, 75 to 85%. Maybe you could just explain at the top, you know, what are we talking about, and how does it work that if enough people are vaccinated, other people are safe? I don't quite understand that.
Right. Well, I think, you know, it's not an exact science, even though it's science. It depends on how contagious the virus is, how susceptible people are. So you do see ranges, but the range that I've seen the most often is that if 75 to 85% of us are not hosting the virus, it has no place to land, so to speak. And we're going to curtail its ecosystem, basically. It's not going to have a place to land. That's why the vaccines are so important. If we can get to that magic range of 75 to 85%, we can stop providing a habitat for this virus. And yeah, I've heard Fauci say mostly around that range, around 75 to 80%.
This confused me, though, is my understanding of the vaccine is that you still get COVID, you still can get it, but you're going to be protected from the most serious consequences, and you can still pass it on to other people, which is why you should still continue to wear a mask and social distance even if you're vaccinated. So doesn't it? That's what I kind of get caught up on. Okay.
Yeah, well, that's a concern, because we don't have enough data yet. The trials the main thing the trials asked, the outcomes that they were looking for, was did the control groups differ from the groups that got the vaccine in terms of the severity of illness, symptomatic disease, and death? Those were the outcomes for the study. Now, that's not the same as you could as we all know, there's a lot of people with asymptomatic disease or milder symptoms. And so we can't tell without more people being entered or follow-up studies whether or not people have been, you know, whether or not we've stopped transmission. We know we have stopped death and we know we've stopped very severe illness, but we can't say with certainty that we've stopped transmission. That's the reason for the more difficult message about masking and social distancing. But although no one can say that for sure yet, there is really comforting evidence. For example, Israel has now vaccinated so many people that they're starting to see declines that suggest that in fact there is a positive effect on transmission. So the vaccines might vary in how much they affect transmission, but there are some really promising signs. I think it's...
So when you say 75 to 85, I think we're at 30 or 35 nationally. I can't remember exactly, but you're thinking that about 75, 80, we should start seeing the same effects that have happened in Israel.
Yeah, I mean, 60% of Americans say they intend to get vaccinated. So we have to get up another 15 to 20%. And then we're going to be facing three major barriers. I don't want to get ahead of you, Chip, but
that was coming. You know,
because I mean, I think we're in the United States, we're going to be very lucky that we are going to have enough vaccine. You know, supply is not going to be the problem for us, but we're going to face three other challenges. Will all of us, will it be available to all of us? You know, a domestic access problem, because right now we know, for example, that many fewer black and brown communities are vaccinated than white communities. And that there are strong concerns in rural America. About half of evangelical groups say that they're resistant to this. So one question is, even though we have supply, will we actually have uptake? Will we have access? Will we make it available for people in an easy way where they are and where they can get to it? So that's an access problem. And then we have a global access problem.
Yeah, I was going to say the global access problem seems more dire in that you don't have access, plus you may have resistance, whereas at least in the United States, if you can convince people, at least the vaccine is available, right? If they can be persuaded to overcome whatever resistance they have. Totally different situations in a way, right? Between the U.S. and globally.
Well, not completely different. You know, vaccine hesitancy is both a domestic issue here and affects people's attitudes in other countries. 5,000 vaccines were delivered to Uganda and for a prior problem, and only 500 takers because they were using some of the same arguments that they heard among those who were vaccine hesitant here. So we're influential whether we want to be or should be. And there are other reasons inside other countries that may not be the same as our reasons for hesitancy. So I think it's a global problem, and we have to solve this because otherwise we're allowing the variants to develop, and we're only as safe as all of us who have access.
What happens with the herd immunity? You know, what I gather is they don't know if we're going to be having to have boosters a year from now, or is this going to become like the flu shot?
Right.
You have to do it annually. You'd hope that maybe, I mean, would herd immunity play a role in that? That you would reach herd immunity and then just have to keep it going every year to get that same number of people?
We're probably going to have booster shots. The good news is that this mRNA technology is a very effective way to be able to make changes rather easily as we genomically sequence these variants. We can see how they're constructed, and then we can make changes and make booster shots. So, yeah, we're going to have to keep ahead of it.
One thing I found in my reading on the Hastings Center site when I got lost there, I was fascinated by Catherine Brown. She wrote this essay about, it was partly collective action problem, and then the tragedy of the commons was fascinating to me that Garrett Hardin had presented. And Is that something you could talk about, the tragedy of the commons? Are you familiar with it enough, you think?
Well, I'm familiar with the tragedy of the commons, but I have to confess that I haven't read her piece.
Oh, no, that's okay. Well, let me read some of it because it's really good. It's she said, the tragedy of the commons reveals that what is good for the individual is at odds with what is good for all. This is the basic logic of collective action problems. We see a similar logic in the case of vaccines. If most people get vaccinated, then everyone will be better off, but it would be best for any particular individual if all others got vaccinated and he or she did not. And so there's this kind of logic that she said about anti-vaxxers, you know, they're not ill-informed parents. They're acting rationally. The trouble is that if enough of them generate the tragedy of the commons, the vaccination levels drop and the measles, in this case, you're talking about the measles, rise. I thought it was interesting that, you know, you do have to think, one of the challenges of this is getting people to think about the community.
Yes.
Right? You can't think about, I don't need to get the vaccine. And I think that's been one of the big challenges for the past year, even, you know, with COVID, is saying to people, well, sure, you might get it and be fine. But it, you always hear that over and over. It's the grandma. It's the grandma when you take it home to grandma.
Yeah.
So I thought that was interesting because it kind of crossed into what you guys, you know, the ethics, the moral, the philosophy that of how we think about the world. And I also think is, you know, that just contradicts kind of what Americans, how we approach things versus other parts of the world, is that we are very individual, very individualistic. We talk about how that's part of our genetics from when it was founded and all this kind of thing. But it is, that seems like a big challenge to get people to think collectively, you know, what is good for the neighborhood, what is good for the,
which you are,
what you do, right?
I mean, you are a very good reader of our website. I'm glad you got lost there for over an hour because what you've named actually is part of the reason the Hastings Center got started. Our founder was a philosopher who was very concerned that we had overly simplistic notions of liberty that overrode our commitments to the common good. And so there is a through line in a lot of our work that is trying to elevate our concern for the common good and our recognition that our hope that we all see ourselves as within a single experiment, you know, called democracy, and that we care enough about each other that we try to build a society that helps everybody flourish. I've been concerned that it's troubled me that people have used liberty as the excuse to say, oh, you know, wearing a mask is an erosion of my liberty. Socially distancing is an erosion of my liberty. I think that is an extraordinarily thin notion of what liberty is. Mm-hmm. My liberty is really hurt a lot more if I get very sick. You know, staying healthy is good for my liberty, but, you know, not wearing a mask is not really going to be a big erosion of my liberty. And so I think we've had a kind of confusion about that very important value of freedom and autonomy, which is also central in American bioethics. Obviously, we want liberty. We want to promote autonomy. We want our civil liberties. But to rebel against something as simple as a mask, as a life-saving mechanism, just seems to me to miss the point of liberty. The point of liberty is to be able to pursue your own life goals. And you can't do that very well from a hospital bed.
Yeah, I mean, it's respecting other people's right to liberty, in effect, right?
As
I mean,
well.
But I think the aspect of community is important because, you know, liberty doesn't exist in a vacuum. The reason we have liberty is because of the community, is because of all the protections that are built in both to the Constitution, system, and that kind of thing. But yeah, that's
license, right, Chip? I think that's what you're saying. Liberty is not doesn't mean license to do anything you please.
That's right.
Liberty has certain limits, and the earliest political philosophers recognized that and talked about that from the very beginning. Liberty is not like the same thing as license. We don't get to harm other people.
we're getting, we get such mixed messages, you can sort of understand. I mean, the politicians, the leaders can't get on the same page about it, which I think doesn't help the situation. There's not any, seemingly any compromise. You know, where in the middle do you meet on this? You do have to give up a little liberty, I guess, if you want to define it that way, but it's an unusual situation as well. This isn't something that has ever happened before. It's very, I know just from looking at the number of webcasts you've done and the and the number of articles that, you know, this is something that you all have been thinking about in different ways at the Hastings Center, even before the pandemic, right? I mean, the larger themes of this.
Yes.
Where do those things collide? Where do they meet?
Yeah. We're interested in collective problems, you know, like, for example, right now, one of the major technologies is human gene editing, and we'll be able to, and good for, you know, good that we've learned so much about genomic medicine, that, but we are now have the power to make some changes, even permanent changes to the human species. And what we do will affect all of us. It's not just a decision about, do I want to get vaccinated, but what should our science policies be about some of the things that will affect all of us? And that's a collective problem. It's not something we can decide one by one. It's going to affect all of us. Climate change is another example of something that requires a collective solution. And so we have to get out of this notion of this highly individualistic notion that it's just up to me to decide how I want to lead my life. I mean, we've really got to work together to solve some common problems and to hopefully create, you know, a more, a world with more opportunities for us to support one another rather than just looking out for uno numero.
Yeah. I did get a question from somebody in the audience that thought was good. You know, do the people who've had COVID and recovered, are they part of the calculation for herd immunity?
Yes, they are. And I've heard, seen scientists including them in the estimates, but nobody knows how long that kind of immunity from having been sick lasts in comparison to whether, you know, how long it lasts for those who are vaccinated. There's some suggestion that the vaccine will be more powerful and more enduring, but we don't know. Nobody knows. And so it's really important for people who've been sick with COVID to get vaccinated.
Yeah, that's interesting. So you should still, I have family members who got it, and I was going to just encourage them to go get it as well. Still get the vaccine. I mean, it's not going to hurt you to get the vaccine after you've had it, and it, because you don't know like whether you've got natural immunity or how long it would last. And that kind of.
Yeah, it's what, really wise to do it.
What have you there thought, or have your scholars discussed, you know, what approaches of policies are best to persuade people who are reluctant for whatever reason? I know there's some reasons listed on the site. You've got conspiracy theories. You've got people who are just uncomfortable with vaccines in general. People who are distrustful of the fact it was developed very quickly, distrustful of the government in general. I mean, what's the... And you also see many different ways, like how to, you know, convince your family member or whatever. But has that been a topic of discussion among scholars there?
Yeah, yes, it has. And we're following a lot of developments. Let me start with the first part. The messenger for this is probably more important than as important as the message. And what I mean by that is, the programs that seem to be, the approaches that seem to be most effective are ones that have tried to identify well-respected, trusted leaders at the local level from within a given community. One of the things that makes it hard is that the different groups that are maybe hesitant to get vaccinated all have different reasons. So one national program isn't likely to be effective. We have to do something that's targeted and respectful to each group's concerns. And respectful is an important word to underline. It should be based on listening to what their questions are and really treating those questions very seriously on their own merits. And identifying people that are trusted. So there's a very good program for example, that Black physicians have started called The Conversation Among Us For Us, in which we see, you know, trusted and esteemed Black physicians and others. Like they used W. Kamau Bell from CNN to be a spokesperson. It's very well done, and it has a lot of recognizable leading Black figures. There is a evangelical minister named Curtis Chang, who has really thought hard about what are the questions that the evangelical community is raising. And it's troubling because there's 40 million white evangelicals, and 45% of them are saying they don't want to get the vaccine. That's a lot of people, about 20 million people. Mm-hmm. So he's been taking their religious questions very, very seriously and developing answers in their own terms, demonstrating that you can lead a religious life true to your own tenets, and getting vaccinated doesn't undermine that. So very respectful, and a leader coming from within that community who is respected. There's a program by an Hispanic physician from Yale who has been translating materials into Spanish and developing ways to reach out to the Latinx community. And The Lancet, just a few days ago, published a really promising report on an effort to reach the African-American community in Philadelphia. And this was a partnership of an academic medical center in Philadelphia, a community hospital, and a well-respected community-based organization. I'm not sure what kind it was. Maybe it was a housing authority or a tenant association or something like that. And they all worked together, and they designed a way to bring, this is the access issue I mentioned at the top, to bring the vaccines into their, you know, very local, easy to get to places. I'm not sure what it was in this case, maybe barbershops and beauty parlors or housing projects. And they've shown really high rates of vaccination due to those efforts. So really working locally, really listening, answering the specific questions that that community has, and making sure it's delivered by people who are recognized and trusted inside that community. Those are pretty important.
Yeah, you think that would be so much more effective than, I mean, they're spending billions on these advertisements and, you know, they're very generic, go get vaccinated, do it, you know. It almost seems like at this point or at some point, everyone who's going to have seen that ad would already be open to getting vaccinated. You're going to have to send in basically, you know, talk to people in their own turf and address their concerns that way. I wonder too if there, I don't know a better word, peer pressure. You know, we're getting these vaccine cards, and you'd assume at some point that that's going to be a ticket to get into events and to get into places. And yeah, people who aren't vaccinated are going to be excluded. And yeah, so you wonder, you know, when, if that will have an effect on people who aren't necessarily against vaccines or have medical health issues or concerns and that kind of thing, if it'll just be, I want to participate.
And yeah,
trust me.
Yeah, I kind of think it will be an incentive. And there are surveys that show that, the last one I saw is something like, it's not a huge amount, but still everybody counts as we're trying to get to that magic number. About 7% of people said they didn't want to get vaccinated, but if it was became really required, you know, to for them to travel or to do something they really wanted to do, then they probably would get vaccinated. So they're in that movable middle, right? Those, yeah. Some people call them swing voters, that, you know, you can, they might go one way or the other. And there's certain things we could do to, you know, move them in the direction towards vaccination. And I thought that was also wise advice. Don't necessarily put your effort into trying to change people who are absolutely into conspiracy theories or absolute no's. But there's a significant number, at least 20% of us, that are saying they're in a wait and see, or a, if they require it, I will. Mm-hmm. And if the majority of that 20% could be moved to, along with the 60% that have said, yes, we'd be there. So
yeah, I'm hopeful about that, because I think it is sort of, I'm sure with some people, it is a wait and see. And then you have things, you know, it's too bad that Johnson & Johnson, yeah, news that broke, because, you know, it is not to diminish the, you know, the death and the, what's happened to people, but statistically it's like six people out of millions and millions of people. Yeah. And they do should address it, but it's just, you just think if somebody had doubts, that that just plays right into it, right? This is dangerous, and if, and they should have waited and all this kind of thing. So, yeah, what was your reaction to that?
Yeah. So this morning we had a very heated, in a good way, kind of, you know, lively email discussion amongst several of us about whether this was a wise move or not on the part, you know, to pause this, because it is so, there are so many more people that will die for not getting one of these vaccines than would die from this problem. But at the end of the day, most of us thought it should, that you have to be transparent. And if, and we've made a pledge that we're going to be as safe can be. And so pause to try to figure it out seemed like a way of demonstrating transparency, and hopefully would build trust rather than not doing something and then being accused of, you know, taking corners. So that's where we came out. But I have to tell you, I've just, people at the Hastings Center were following the CDC advisory committee meeting that happened this afternoon, and they've kicked the ball down the road. They said they have to meet again, that they didn't have enough data to decide. So basically that's a decision to keep this pause going. And that's certainly going to harm, you know, that's, it's not good.
What data do they need? They basically have to try to identify something in those seven people that's a common underlying cause, maybe, that they could say to people, if you have this, don't take Johnson & Johnson, right? I mean, otherwise, if there's no connection between, they were all female, but beyond that, if there's no connection, they're kind of stuck. So you do have, it's a perfect example of the kind of ethical issues you know, Hastings is looking at. Like, how do you decide, you know, somebody's going to die from the vaccine, in that case, some small amount of people, but on the other hand, without it, but then we have other vaccines. So it isn't like that's the only vaccine as well. So, what, somebody asked a good question, another good question, which is, what do you say, this will be coming more probably, you know, I chose not to get vaccinated, but now I'm being discriminated against, because I mean, what, those issues are gonna, I can see that in the courts, right? You know, somebody's, I made this personal choice and now you are saying I can't eat at your restaurant, or the orders start to expire.
I really don't have much patience for that claim. I don't think that anyone can call this a matter of discrimination. There's hundreds of years of history of societies working together for the common good when they faced an existential threat. I mean, you know, we've been doing much more powerful measures hundreds of years ago in creating quarantine and isolation and cordoning off whole communities to manage infectious disease. It's a huge, long, well-established history of taking action to save the most lives and to preserve our society. So I think it's a really weak and an example of the problem you named at earlier in the conversation of as Americans, it seems like our first reaction is me, individualism, and not us, you know. And I think that's our biggest problem in fighting this disease. Well, we just have to come together.
Common enemy. I mean, you know, World War II, and it's just odd that this isn't viewed that way. I guess it's difficult because you can't see it. It's hard to conceive of the fact that this thing you can't see would kill you, and how it kills you, and so there's differences there, I guess. But it is interesting that there were never that kind of immediate collective, we have to stop this, and it's mixed up in a lot of different areas, I'm sure.
Chip, you know, I think it's a symptom of some erosion of our democracy and of the vitality of our society that's been going on for a long time. And now faced with this real threat, all these ongoing factors are coming together in a very negative way to make it hard for us to manage this threat. We managed World War II. It, as you say, was a source of alignment of energy, you know, and we built back better with the GI Bill and all that, creating, you know, a flourishing middle class. But now we have a, you know, we have no business base for good journalism. Go Highlands Current. You know, you put in a plug for the Hastings Center. I'll put in a plug for this fabulous local newspaper that is doing such a good job in a time in our history when we don't have a sound business model for healthy journalism. And so we've got all this fake stuff that's going on the internet without any ground rules or norms for controlling it. We've had enormous gaps in material inequality, wealth gaps in the last 20, 30 years, where the rich have gotten much richer and we've left behind many people who had better paying manufacturing jobs. And that's fueled a kind of distrust and a kind of populism and distrust, you know, distrust, I think, is a big word here. So it's not only that it's a terrible virus and that it's a big threat, but we've kind of lost some of the resources or assets that we might have deployed to come together. And instead, because we're so polarized, our ability to deal with it is undermined.
Yeah, I mean, it's been kind of unrelenting. You know, you talk about the news cycle and it can get very depressing. I do think personally, just having written about this every week for more than a year, in fact, I thought we should do a contest that people could guess which issue of the Current will not have the word coronavirus in it. You know, will it be 2022, 2025? I don't know. But I'm always brought back, though, but there are hopeful things. I mean, I think the country's never dealt with this before. Now we have, right? So the next time it won't be this. I just don't think there'll be this kind of immediate resistance. We've seen 500,000 people die. I mean, you know, it's right in front of us. And I also think if you look at the healthcare, the organization of these vaccine distribution for the, you know, has been going, I mean, pretty well considering the massive undertaking it was.
Yeah.
Many people are getting the vaccine. I mean, we're talking about trying to get 20%, right? Well, we've already got most people are like understand the science and aren't afraid. So there are hopeful things, I think.
Yes.
As well, and also I think of, you know, we bring up World War II, but one thing I could never get my head around in the beginning was the healthcare workers who went in, and many of them died, like initially, right? And we didn't know much about it. We had somebody in our own community who was, you know,
terrible.
Working. And so I look at that and think, would I be able to do that? I don't know. Would I be able to go in this unknown thing? And it's easy a year later to go, well, of course, we learned so much in the year, and they did a vaccine in a year, which is amazing. So part of me, you know, when I try to talk to people who are reluctant to get the vaccine, is just to say, look, do it sort of as a thank you. Mm-hmm. It's amazing. In 1 year, they came up with not one, but three vaccines for this thing that nobody knew what it was 15 months ago. Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's amazing. And so that should give you faith that it isn't, you know, hasn't gone through the process that you would normally do, but it's an emergency situation. And millions of people have gotten the vaccine, and nobody, you know, people are not, there's not massive problems.
And do it for your kids. You know, they can't be vaccinated, so they still can catch it. Do it. I mean, I think we should name altruistic reasons to do it. But, well, for your kids is your own interest, too. But also do it, you know, do it for your neighbors. We've got to do it for each other. I hope we'll get to a place where we can think about it beyond our own convenience or our own.
Well, it goes back to the question that, you know, from a few minutes ago, what are the strategies that are effective to convince people who are reluctant? And I guess the answer is you're going to target those 20% of people who are reluctant for I don't know, like
that are mobile.
Medically, yeah. be tough to, or you have a conspiracy theory in your head or something, that's tougher to convince than those 20% who are just inconvenienced. You know, I can't get over there.
Or think that it's a threat to their religion. So the evangelical program is to show them it's not a threat. It doesn't try to convince them, doesn't try to turn them away from their own beliefs, but to show how this would be consistent with their beliefs. So avoiding binaries. You can have a religious life and get vaccinated. You can live, on the left, we have people who think it's not natural. So you can have a natural life and get vaccinated. And, you know, avoiding binaries, trying to help people see how inside their own worldview, consistent with who they believe themselves to be, they can still do this. I think that's an important part of how the message is framed. And then if that's delivered by people they trust who are inside their own community, then it has a chance, a fighting chance.
Yeah. You just hope it's not 95%. You know, you hope that it is that you'll see that in the numbers at 75%. So. All right. Well, we've gone over. I'm kind of looking here.
The software doesn't shut us down, huh?
Yeah, that might be the way to do it because it could go on forever. Yes. Oh, there's Teresa. She came back. Yeah, I think we've got. I mean,
we could talk for another hour about this, I'm sure.
Yeah. Let her go. We try to keep them to 30 minutes or so and bring people back, which we may have to do.
Well, yeah. And as you said at the start, we are having the same discussion on these same topics on
right.
the 20th. Just go to thehastingscenter.org. You have to put the in.
Right. I just wrote down their names, but who are
they're
the
really people? Fascinating. So Rhea Boyd, who is an African-American physician at the Palo Alto Medical Foundation. She's one of the founders of this program called the Conversation, which I mentioned earlier, which is stories told by Black physicians and Black well-known Black figures to try to encourage people to trust and the vaccine. And she's also doing a lot to encourage not just trust, but access in communities of color. And Maya Goldenberg, who is a philosopher of science from the University of Guelph in Canada, has just written a book called Vaccine Hesitancy. And spoiler alert, she unpacks the common complaint is that, you know, we're in a post-expert world, that nobody pays attention to expertise anymore, and it's an anti-science world. And she unpacks that and says instead that she thinks we're in a place of great distrust, and that we have to focus. It's not that people are ignorant or don't believe in science. It's that they don't believe in one another, basically. That we're in this untrustworthy place. And that, so she's going to be talking about that.
Oh, that's fascinating. And that's, what time is that on Tuesday?
You ask me things I do not know. Let me check my trusty iPhone here.
Does that sound right?
Hold on. I know nothing without looking here. It is 1 o'clock. Yes. On Tuesday, the 20th.
Oh, it's at 1 o'clock. Sorry.
1 o'clock. I didn't hear what you said. Did you? Yeah. 1 o'clock Eastern.
Center.org.
Thehastingscenter.org. Yep. Mm-hmm. It's called Vaccine Access, Vaccine Hesitancy.
Well, thank you very much, Millie. I appreciate the time. I feel much better now, much more educated.
Thank you very much. I really enjoyed it. And congratulations on just a spectacular paper. Really, really great.
All right. Thank you so much. And just so everybody knows, the recording is going to be posted right on the same link. Just a few minutes after the event is done, we'll post a link on our website to you if anybody wants to share with friends or anybody who couldn't attend. Thank you so much, everyone. Have a good night.
Good night.